prophecy of the Pharisees. Luke 14, verse 1 says, and it came to pass, as he went into the house of one of the chief Pharisees to eat bread on the Sabbath day, that they watched him. And behold, there was a certain man before him which had a dropsy. And Jesus answering spake unto the lawyers, lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? And they held their peace. He took him, and he healed him, and he let him go. And answered them, saying, which of you shall have an ass or an ox fall into a pit, and will not straightway pull him out on the Sabbath day? And they could not answer him again to these things. And so Jesus, throughout his ministry, was a constant battle. If you read your Bible, you know that this is so. Jesus, throughout his ministry, was in constant battle with the religious people of his day, even up to his death. In our text tonight, Jesus enters the house, the Bible says, of one of the chief Pharisees. His purpose was to eat with them. However, when he got there and saw a man in need of help, the scriptures teach us that those that were there, lawyers, the Pharisees, and the other religious leaders, watched Jesus because they knew a problem was about to take place. Listen, Jesus didn't just come into a place and saw things happening and kept quiet. When Jesus came into a place and things were not the way it should be, he spoke up. And this was what was about to take place. Jesus, Harold saw someone drifting away. Jesus was ever cognizant of the fact that the season of harvest would come to an end. So he had to draw the lifeline in this situation. The Bible said of the religious people, the scribes, the Pharisees, the lawyers, the Sadducees. The Bible says that they watched him. And the reason they watched him is because they know trouble was brewing. You say, what do you mean trouble was brewing? It was the Sabbath. But trouble wasn't just brewing because it was the Sabbath and they were in this Pharisee's house. Trouble was brewing because there was a man here in need. And Jesus had the choice of throwing out the lifeline or keeping quiet. He had to decide if he was going to offend these Pharisees. It was a Sabbath day. And if you know anything about the Sabbath day, you were not allowed to do any work. You could not light a fire. You were not even allowed to walk a mile. You were not allowed to pick up a stick on the Sabbath. You read the Old Testament, you will see what happened to a woman for picking up sticks on the Sabbath day. She was immediately put to death. And so it was the Pharisees, when Jesus stepped into that house, they saw this man there that was in need, they immediately became uneasy. Because they knew that anything that was out of order was going to be addressed by Jesus. Because his primary function in life was not to please mankind. His primary function in life was not to be popular. His primary function in life was to fulfill the will of God. And to do the things that please his Father. That's our problem today. We're so busy trying to please man that we forget that we're supposed to be trying to please God the Father. And so we acquire many of things. We don't stand up for many of things. Why? Because we are more concerned about the opinion and the praises of men than one day hearing God say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. So when Jesus walked in, the Pharisees and the lawyers knew trouble was brewing. Jesus was not afraid to stand for right and helping human beings. The Pharisees, during Jesus' ministry, was constantly trying to trap him. The Pharisees was one of those religious groups in Jesus' day. They said there was a resurrection, at least they got that right, which contradicted the Sadducees, who said that there was no resurrection. They thought that when you were dead, you were done. And Jesus, in the house of this chief Pharisee, and in his house, there was a man who was in desperate need. This man, the Bible says, has a disease known as dropsy. This man has a disease known as dropsy. Now, right away, some people may think about the disease dropsy, the day when people fall asleep easy. No. The Bible says, and behold, there was a sick man before him which had dropsy. In dropsy, the body, this disease that the Bible speaks about, the body is retaining water to its limbs, fingers, foot, and other parts of the body become swollen. Our fingers tend to be bigger than normal. Feet may be bigger than normal. Hands, different body parts, because it's an indication that the water is being retained in the body somewhere. There's another problem in the body somewhere else, resulting in water being retained in the foot, the leg, the arm, and other places of the body. This man is sitting here with dropsy. And Jesus, being who he was on the Sabbath, he could care less what day it was. Why? Because Jesus was a compassionate man. And for this, Jesus feels compassion for this man. He sees and knows the hearts of the Pharisees, however. He knows the heart and the minds of the lawyers. And so Jesus asks these religious people, is it good? Is it okay to do good on the Sabbath? Guess how quiet it is, and guess how quiet it was then. The Bible says they open them up. My. When our hearts and minds become cold, callous to the needs of people, especially people that we are supposed to love and care about. These people could care nothing about the compassion that should be demonstrated to mankind. They were more wrapped up in their ritualistic beliefs and their rules and regulations. Jesus answered and spake unto the lawyers and Pharisees, the Bible saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? Interestingly, when he asked this question, they all said nothing. They kept quiet. Seeing their hypocrisy, Jesus took the man, healed him, the Bible said, and let him go. The Bible says, and they held their peace. He took him, the man that is, and healed him, and he let him go. Our primary function is not to be concerned about what people may think. Our primary function is to do right. Do right no matter what. And our primary function is to help mankind wherever we can help mankind. That is why this debate that goes on between vaccination and not vaccination is so silly. It's an individual choice. And somebody asks you if they should do it, you tell them that it's more important for you to trust Jesus Christ as Lord and as personal Savior. Because you're going to die. Whether you take it or don't take it, you're going to die. But where are you going to spend eternity when you do die? Nobody is in a hurry to die. You want to go to heaven, but nobody is joining the line right now or rushing to join the line right now. But whenever it happens, you want to be ready to face your Master. You want to be ready to face your Lord and your Savior, Jesus the Christ. Jesus is upset at the hypocrisy that is being displayed by the religious crowd. And this man is sitting there, naked, careless, pointing out the hypocrisy. Jesus
said to them, which of you, listen, man, boy, sometimes we can be really bad. Jesus said, which of you will have an ass or an oxen fall into the ditch and will not go and pull him out, securing your animal on the Sabbath day? You see the hypocrisy. They said, no work should be done on the Sabbath. There should be a day of rest. But Jesus said, if one of your donkey or your oxen fall in a ditch or a pit on the Sabbath day, you will gladly go down into that pit and get your oxen or get your donkey out. And here it is, you do not want me to be a human being on the Sabbath day. Something wrong with you. People all around us are in need of help and opportunities for us to minister to them, and yet still we are silent. What an opportunity to try to get help for the man to manage to lift his crowd, but they were quiet. Jesus pointed out the hypocrisy to them. Jesus showed how these ritualistic Pharisees and lawyers were hypocrites in the highest order. They were more concerned with animals and laws more than they cared about human needs. The Bible says in verse 5 of our text, and answered them, saying, which of you shall have an ass or an ox fall into a pit and not straightway pull him out on the Sabbath day? Jesus made sure, pointed out how hypocritical they were. You'll do it on the same day that you say is so sacred, you will go and get your donkey or your oxen out, but you have forsaken the needs of human beings. Something is wrong with that. Jesus points this out to them. He says to them, something wrong with you. He asked them, saying, which of you should have an ass or an ox fall into the pit? You will not straightway, immediately, put him on the Sabbath day. Guess what? They were silent. Very quickly, for the next few minutes, I want to try to see where we can get on. I pointed a couple of things that I've observed from this passage. First and foremost, Jesus has a concern for all. Watch this. Sometimes, if we read this, we'll think Jesus would only be around the man with the dropsy. But the house that Jesus was in was that of a religious man. There were lawyers there. There was this man, this sick man was there. And that's how life is when it comes to getting the gospel out. Listen, church, we're going to run into all kinds of people. We're going to run into rich, poor, not so poor. We're going to run into black, white, yellow, green, pink. We're going to run into people of all races, Haitian, Jamaican, Bahamian, Jew. We're going to run into all of them. But if you want to be like Jesus, I'm telling you tonight, church, you know, need God concern for all mankind. All mankind. Every nationality, every skin color, every language you come into contact with, you have concern for them because they're all candidates for heaven and all candidates for hell. The one thing that is standing between them going to heaven and going to hell might be you presenting them with the gospel and demonstrating some concern for them. Jesus went to the house of Zacchaeus. Went looking for Zacchaeus one day. Zacchaeus was a tax collector. He was not too popular. He was a Jew collecting taxes for the Roman government. So that made him hated by the people of his day, the citizens of his day. And not only that, tax collectors were crooks. They oftentimes would take more money than they were supposed to take from the people. And that didn't make them too popular. And the Bible says that Jesus, in spite of this, told Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus climbed up in the tree because he wanted to see Jesus. When he climbed up in the tree because he wanted to see Jesus, the Bible says that Jesus came by and he said, Zacchaeus, come down. For I must abide with thee this day. You gotta understand that we gotta have concern for all. You notice Jesus had concern for Zacchaeus, and Jesus has concern for this sheep of the Pharisee. And Jesus, as we will see in a few minutes, was very hard on the Pharisees. There's a lot of religious people that need to hear the gospel. There's a lot of church-going people that need to hear the gospel. Listen, not because you're religious means that you go into heaven. No more you being born in a garage makes you a car. And so we ought to be concerned for all mankind until we hear their testimony of whether they have accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and as personal Savior. This week I read a story and you're very familiar with it. You've read it many times in your Bible. Just like I've read it many times in my Bible. The Bible says it's coming a time when at the great day of judgment. I've got to say it's got to be the great white throne judgment. Because no Christian will be before the great white throne judgment. And the Bible says that these people are standing before God. And their claim to get into heaven, brother, is the fact that they have prophesied in the, you hear me? They have prophesied in the name of Jesus. They have preached in the name of Jesus. They have cast out demons in the name of Jesus. They have done many wonderful works in the name of Jesus. And then Jesus is going to look them in the eye and say, this is what you are banking on to get into heaven. Jesus will say to them, I never knew you. You hear me? He didn't say I knew you and you got shy. He said, I never knew you. It doesn't matter who the person is. You come in contact with an individual, you tell them about Jesus. Make sure that you hear their testimony. Because religious people need to be saved. Choir members are not saved, they're going to go to hell. If prayer stand members have not have the certainty of their salvation, and they don't accept Jesus before leaving this earth, they will die and go to hell. If ushers and deacons, and listen, you have to trust Jesus. Jesus didn't take any chance. He goes into the house of this Pharisee. And it doesn't matter where you are, you are to spread the gospel. There was a religious man here. But not only was there, the Bible says, and it came to pass, as he went into the house of one, listen, the chief Pharisee, my Lord. And he was there, the Bible says, to eat bread on the Sabbath day. And the Bible says that they watched him. Boy, you can imagine some of the people saying, oh, I'm not troubling you today. You know, Jesus is a troublemaker. Oh, he can stir something today. He can do something today. Jesus entered the house of this Pharisee who undoubtedly had a need, but this Pharisee had a need, but Jesus also met a man with dropsy. And the sad thing about this is the religious men, the Pharisees and the lawyers, they think they are okay because they have placed their religion above biblical truth, which will land you in trouble, in a place called hell, far away from God. If your religion does not move from your head to your heart, you are in plenty of trouble. The Bible tells us, the Word of God tells us, if any man among you seem to be religious and branded not his tongue, but the sin of his own heart, this man's religion is vain. He says, pure religion, undefiled before God the Father says, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep themselves unspotted from the world. Your religion. And you say, you have religion, it should make it to your heart. And when it makes it to your heart, it will change your life. It will cause you to have what Jesus has here, compassion. It will cause you to have what Jesus has here, of wanting to help human beings. Problem with the Pharisees was their religion, never made it to their hearts. The point that Jesus was concerned about, all not just all is not well, and not everybody in society is
being saved if they're not saved.
Scripture says he heals the man and let him go. Thank God, 30 plus years ago, he healed me. And he let me go. 40 plus years ago, he healed some of you and he let you go. He unloosed you. He unwrapped you. He loosed you from the bonds of sin and he set you free. So we have a lot to be thankful for. The Bible is clear. The scripture says he healed the man and let him go. That was his mission. He didn't walk into the house and worry about what the Pharisees and state was thinking. That's our problem in 2021 as Christians. We get into a place and we see the need. We are too concerned about what people think about what people say. We are too concerned about how they feel. Well, the Bible says that Jesus wasn't concerned about that because his will was the boss. That's what he said in Luke. One group of people, religious, one man, in a helpless state. This is the picture of the world. Some trying to earn their way to heaven. It can't happen. Now they realize that they're helpless and they need God. That's what Jesus sees in this house. So I'm telling you, we need to be concerned like Jesus was concerned. Every day of our lives, we ought to be concerned. We talk about the amount of people dying. That should motivate us. That should motivate us too. Boy, if somebody gets around you, you better tell them about the Lord.
Right.
And you better tell them about a Savior. Because you do not know it may be the last time. We've been saying that for years, but at no point in our history, I believe, my opinion, I believe, and I don't have to be right, but at no point in history have I seen people die so fast. And such a volume. At no point. Death seemed to be rampant and everywhere. Every time you turn around, it seems like somebody's being snatched out into eternity. So that is why when we come in contact with them, we've got to share the gospel. We can't worry about how they feel. We can't worry about what religion they are. We can't worry about what they think about the Sabbath. We can't worry about who they are, how intelligent they may think they are. We've got to see them as eternal souls, headed for an eternal destiny. When Jesus walked into the Pharisee house, the chief Pharisee, he was there to eat food. When he saw something more important than eating food, he saw a matter that needed to be addressed. That matter was the matter of this man with a dropsy. He saw somebody who needed to be set free. And that's how we need to see people, as people who need to be set free by the grace of God. I talked to you about sin. Jesus saw the condition of these people. Look at the coldness of the religious group. The coldness of the religious group. When asked for helping this man, they knew Jesus was talking about. I believe that all my heart. When asked for helping this man, the scripture says the Pharisees and the lawyers refused to answer. Jesus twice asked them. The careless attitude of the Pharisees is shown. Jesus knew their hearts. After all, he was God himself. Amen. Quickly used their animals falling into a ditch. And say how quickly they would jump into the ditch rescuing the animals. But they were against helping and meeting human needs. The Pharisees were doing that which is atypical of Christians. That is shedding of our bowels of compassion. I want to warn us this evening. I want to warn you. As a believer, and warn me as a believer, that we be careful that we don't shed up our bowels of compassion, that we keep our eyes peeled to the needs of saints and sinners. Because the opening of your bowels as towards saints and sinners, it'll let them know how much you really love them. It'll let them know how much you really care about them. When we open up our compassion, the sinner will be more inclined to listen to you when you see a demonstration of your love towards him. Listen to what John the Eighth Apostle said. Hereby perceive we the love of God. Why? How do we know God loves us? We see the compassion. The The Bible says, because he laid down his life for us. That's how you know God loves you. That's how you know Jesus loves you. The Bible said, he laid down his life for us. And he said, we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Whoso had this world's good, seeing his brother have need, shutting up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God by God? When you think about this and you compare what is taking place in Luke, our gospel, our chapter number 14, your heart really goes out to the Pharisees and the Sadducees and to the lawyers and the chief priests, because they were in a sad, sad, sad state. The Bible says, my little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. Our religious beliefs are weak. We see people in physical and spiritual needs and say, no, I'm turning away. The Pharisee here, this is where they live. Their religious beliefs trump human needs. My mind goes to night when Jesus thought about the Good Samaritan. And he asked the lawyer, he said, who's your neighbor? And he told the lawyer the story about how this man was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. How this man was attacked and beaten and left there. And how this religious people came by. Boy, religion is a dangerous thing. Be not careful. These religious people came by. And when these religious people came by, the priest, all concerned about himself, refused to even go over and help this man. Then the Bible says the man that was just under him, the Levite, came by. These were church people, temple folks, folks that talked about God, and they refused that. But not our Jesus. He couldn't come into a situation and not reach out his hand and help. The Bible said that this man, this Samaritan, he came down and he got off his donkey, or whatever his piece of burden might have been. And the Bible says he took the man and put oil and wine in his wound to ease the pain of what he was experiencing. Because that's what Christians do. We love. We demonstrate our love by not only word, but by our action. We hear of somebody in need, and we go and we meet those needs. This man was in need, the Bible said, this good Samaritan took him and put him on his donkey and rode him to an inn and placed him in the inn and took care of him. And that when it was time for him to go, the Bible said, he says to the innkeeper, you finish taking care of him. And listen, whatever he owes, my God, he said, put it on my top. Why, oh Lord, but thank God, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. He paid it all. He paid it all for me. Let's come to a close, because time has come and time has swiftly gone by. But I'm going to skip a point and go right to this last point. The man with dropsy. Out of this dropsy, he leaves change. Let me tell you something. Anytime you come in the presence of God, anytime you come in and read the Bible, you can't come in the presence of Jesus and leave the same. Whenever we come here, we come to the house of God, and we ought to leave change. Herbert Barry, myself, and some of the other men say, Lord, when we leave here, please let us leave change. When you enter those doors, there. When you enter those doors, you jump in your car, you say, God, I'm going to your house. Lord, I'm going to your house. I'm nothing, but Lord, when I leave your house, let me leave change. I will be a different man. I will be a different woman when I leave. I love different saying that Jesus, he was in the house of the chief priest. That does not stop him from demonstrating love and compassion for a man in need. Listen, you come in contact with Jesus, like I said, you will lead change. Tonight, behind his presence, we should lead change. Lord, help me to lead change. The woman with the issue of blood met Jesus after 12 years of attending doctors. I don't care how long you've been coming to church, but if you've never left change, you need to lead change. She's been attending the doctors for 12 long years. She said, if I can touch him, I will be changed. I'm telling you tonight, if you can touch Jesus through faith, you will be changed. The Bible says she came behind him, touched the border of his garment, and immediately the issue of her blood stopped. She was changed. Some of us need to be touched. Some of us need to touch Jesus. Jesus said, who touched? Jesus said, you know, if you touch it, because whatever you're going through will be staunched. Jesus will see your faith. Others may not see it. They may not understand. Our desire is to be changed. Jesus said, somebody touched me. Somebody came here wanting to be changed. Somebody came here wanting to be different. How did you come here? Did you come here wanting to live different? If you come to the house of God wanting to live different, you will live different. Mark's gospel tells us about a man in the morning. We're talking about mental health. The Bible, as we come to a close, tells of a man, a demoniac of Gadara. The Bible says this demoniac of Gadara would cut himself. He had supernatural power. They would chain him, but they could not hold it. The chains could not hold it. He would break them. He was not in his right mind. He's not even in his right mind. He slept in the graveyard. Nobody sleeps in the graveyard. If somebody asked you tonight to take a walk in the graveyard, you look at them twice. You're crazy. But this man didn't just walk in the graveyard. He slept there. That he was not in his right mind. Listen, there's mental health now. There's a lot of people who are struggling mentally right now. They're not in their right mind. They're trying to determine if to live or die. And I'm here to tell them if they meet Jesus, he'll have them in their right mind. I didn't say it would be easy, but you can talk there. Bible says in the morning of Gadara, he saw Jesus. Jesus cast the demons out of him. The Bible says the people in that city knew what this man used to do. But when he met Jesus, he was changed. The Bible says when they came out of the city, the demoniac of Gadara, this man was strong and broke chains and stepped on the tombs in the graveyard and tore his clothes and was running about naked. When they saw him again, he was clothed. And the Bible says he was in his right mind. I tell you, 30 plus years ago, I met Jesus. Clothed me. Placed me in my right mind. Listen, it's by grace of God that you're not stealing, killing, murdering, doing the most serious of things. Because why? You met Jesus. And as the world looks at you today, they see you sinning and clothed in your right mind. Because you met Jesus. Let's start. If you do not know the Lord and you're watching, and you're troubled, listen, meet him tonight. You can be clothed in your right mind. Ask him to come into your heart. Ask him to save you. Ask him to forgive you of all your sins. And I promise you, if you do that tonight, he'll save you. And here's now in my schools. Why don't you repeat this prayer after me? If you're watching and you don't know how to save you, say, dear Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that if I die today, I go to hell. And I'm asking you to come into my heart and save. Take me to heaven if you will, I accept the payment you made for me on Calvary's cross. Jesus. And if you are a Christian, you're troubling the back of your mind, I ask you to sit at the feet of Jesus. For the name of Jesus, I talk to this message of brother Jesus.
True compassion, Lord, Father.